seated in the presence of the Lord. You're all welcome in Jesus' name. Okay, we are in the afternoon session of our leadership summit. If you were not here in the morning, trust me, you missed. Praise God. You missed a lot. Professor Vincent Anibogu was with us, taking us through leadership. And please, if you are not here, make sure you get the tape. Praise the Lord. Please ensure you get the tape and listen to that profound teaching, you know, over and over again. Amen. The Bible says that faith cometh by what? Hearing and hearing. So even if you are here, get it, listen to it over and over again. Amen. In this, our second session, we're going to be listening to something akin to what we heard in the morning. In the morning, we took leadership from the, you know, aspect of fundamental imperatives. Amen. We looked at building the Nigeria of our dream, fundamental imperatives. But this afternoon, we are still continuing with building the Nigeria of our dream, the role of leadership. Amen. The role of leadership. And we have a seasoned woman of God in our midst that the introduction is better done from this platform. Praise the Lord. So, media, here we go.
Lady Elishama Ideh was born and raised in Lagos, but a native of Ewohimi in Edo State. She had a primary education at Mayflower Primary School in Kene, Ogun State, and secondary education at Federal Government Girls College, Onitsha, before proceeding to study mass communication at Bowie State College, Maryland, USA. On her return from the US, she went into business and has done extremely well. Please make welcome Lady Elishama Ideh.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Can somebody shout hallelujah in the house? I cannot hear you. Maybe your hallelujah is for your pastor. Eh? Then for me. Can somebody praise the Lord in the house right now? Can you raise your voice and praise the living God? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. I'm so very happy to be in your midst this afternoon. It's a great honor and a great privilege. This is not my first time here. I've been here before, and it was a blessing for me to bless this house. And I know I will be blessed again to bless you. And I pray you will all be blessed in the name of Jesus. Can you just be seated? Once more, good afternoon. Thank you, my dear brother. How many people that knows that your pastor is my brother? I'm not just saying it, that kind of brother, church brother. It's my brother. It's my brother. Not only is he my brother in the Lord, he's my brother. I mean, we all grew up in this family-knitted church in Benin City, a Christian gospel church. In fact, he knows the whole of my family. Your bag will say, oh, mommy, dele, dele. Dele, dele. He knows me to the very core of my home. Hallelujah. And it's always a great privilege to come minister for him and to be in this great house, you know, with God's people. Can somebody shout hallelujah here again? My dear brother, Philip IGBINIJESU, and your dear wife, I know they will be here very soon with the family. I learned they came in last night, and they are jet lagged. They are getting ready to be here. Thank you for having me once more, man of God. I appreciate you. I do not take this for granted in any way. Today, I've been asked to speak, and happy 50th. Can you all celebrate your pastor? Come on now. Stand up and celebrate him. Celebrate him. He's 50 today. Hallelujah. Welcome to the golden age. It's going to be a year of true jubilee for you, my brother. True jubilee in every sense of the word. Round about your life, your ministry, your family, in your personal life, in all that you are trusting God for, receive jubilee. In the name of Jesus. Welcome to the golden club. So you should start calling me sister from now. Hallelujah. So I'm here today. We're going to be talking about we are well able to have capacity for more. Hallelujah. And talking about the role of leadership, you know, and the vision we want for Nigeria. I'm going to lay a foundation of our role in governance just briefly. And I know that we're going to go into a session of a question and answer. Because a lot of people get confused about getting involved as church. People in the church get confused a lot about the church in relationship with government. So when they see you going into politics or trying to be part of building the community, you hear Christians saying, why is this person going into politics? Ah, they will just go and soil themselves. They will get dirty. Then Jesus Christ should not have come into a dirty world now. That's what I always tell people. Let us pray before I continue. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you for this moment. Thank you for the calling. Thank you for the grace to be called to speak your word. Even as we go to share this afternoon, as I share to your people about the role of leadership and the vision that we all have for Nigeria, I pray that you help me to speak clearly into the heart of your people in Jesus' name. And that we have an understanding of their purpose, not only in the church, but also for the nation. I pray in Jesus' name. Help me, Holy Spirit, to deliver. I need your help. We all do, all the time, every time. Help me right now, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, I think I love this topic very much because I went into a dimension of leadership recently before I step aside. I'll call it step aside, more than stepping down. I actually declared to run for the office of the president. I wanted to be the first woman president in Nigeria. Please celebrate me. I deserve an accolade. Even for the boldness, eh? That is to say we have capacity for more. We are well able. As children of God, we have the capacity to be whatever we want to be. We are well able to enter any environment, any territory, and take it over. If you know what you have inside of you, you cannot be limited, you cannot be sidelined. We have the capacity for anything that we put our heart to. But most importantly, we have to have an understanding that God is leading us to go in that direction. Whatever we have been called to do, or whatever we are led to do, we have to be very sure that the Lord is calling us to do it. I declared to run for the office of the president of Nigeria just for one purpose and for one reason. And I'm going to lay that foundation very clearly. I've been in the ministry for 20 years, and in the 20 years of my ministry, I was ministering, or I've been ministering to a marginalized sector of our society. That is the abandoned, poor, widows, needy, homeless, orphans, destitutes, every category of less privileged. And I was so passionate in that calling that no matter what other branches began to come out of my ministry, that was the root of my calling. And I never at any time deviated from that. And going to minister to Nigerians at that level afforded me the opportunity to see the level of squalor that our nation had come into. The squalor was so much that I began to question, you know, why should a nation that is so richly endowed, so richly blessed, yet we are so poor? That was the burden in my heart as I began to witness the decay in the society, and I began to witness the suffering of the generality of our people. And each time I was out there seeing this level of squalor, the only question that coming to my heart was, we are more than this. We are better than this. In fact, when I started with that slogan in my political campaign, a lot of people thought it was a slogan that I just picked for now. But it was a slogan that has been with me for 20 years from the very day I began to observe the level of squalor that we had in the society. The extreme poverty was so much that it was so alarming. And I began to question God. Why should a nation that is so richly blessed, so richly endowed, be living in this level of squalor? Why should people still be living at this level when we are an oil-rich nation? Because of my burden, the Lord began to speak to me about nationhood. He began to speak to me about the responsibility of leaders to their people. In fact, when I was on the political train and I was doing my campaign in most of the places they were inviting me to and they were asking me questions, one of the most fundamental questions they kept asking me was, what is your inspiration in coming into this race? Who inspired you? Who is your mentor? I said, if you have to know the truth, the Holy Spirit inspired me. Because a minister like me had no reason to want to run for an election. But I was so passionate about the work that God committed into my hands, and I was so worried about the state of our nation that by the time I began to speak to the Lord about it, He began to inspire me about nation building, why the church should get involved in our community affairs. In fact, I was one of the major ministers that began to go around to the churches in the early days of my ministry to let them know that our service as Christians should not just stop in the spiritual. Welcome, woman of God. Welcome, man. God bless you. Can we just celebrate the wife of the pastor of the house? Bless you, woman of God. So, I began a sensitization move to the body of Christ, as many that could allow me on their altar to talk to them why we should get involved in building our community and why we should not just sit in church and only be concerned about spiritual things. Because the Bible says we are the salt of the earth, not of the church. Not of the church. And we are the light of the world, not of the church. We need to go put our light out there in darkness. And I want us to quickly look at this scripture before I go back to my foundation in all of this. Colossians 1:16. Colossians 1:16. Are we there? It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him. And for who? All things were created by him. Whether they be thrones or dominions, or principalities, or powers. All things, authorities, all things were created for him and by him. So, governance was created for him. And by him, you can never separate church from governance. presidents, governors, kings, nobody can enter any position of authority if God. Did you see that scripture? If God does not ordain it, it does not matter if the person is bad or good. And that is where a lot of Christians miss it. Anybody God entrusts in the position of authority, he wants to use that person to achieve his ultimate end. Are you listening to me? He said, I created Pharaoh. Pharaoh that put his children in bondage. He said, for this reason, I created him. So that my name will be glorified. For this reason, he was the one that hardened the heart of Pharaoh. Pharaoh did not harden his. All those things that were happening in Egypt, that Pharaoh was refusing to let the children of Israel go. On his own, he could have allowed them to go. But because God wanted to show his mightiness, that in all of these things, whatever you do, it is what I want to happen with my people that will happen. He raised Pharaoh, even in his wickedness. So I always tell people, anytime you see a God raise a leader, and I always say also that a nation deserves the king they get after their hearts. When you are good people, God will give you a good leader that will bring peace upon the nation. Listen, he will also permit a wicked leader to come so that he will eventually achieve his purpose. Because since you people will not quickly appreciate a good leader, he will give you the one after your own heart. Because your attitude, your character, your way is like that person. So now God wants to change the whole nation. So he will make that wicked leader deal with all of you very well. Hello. Then when he finishes using that leader to trash everybody, then everybody will now realize, look, it is not this kind of leader we want. And it is not this kind of nation we want. So they by themselves will begin to cry out for the sort of leader that they want. They by themselves will begin to check themselves about their wickedness, which is what we are going to discuss here today. What sort of leaders do we want? What sort of vision do we have for Nigeria? Hello. The Nigeria of our dream. The role of right leadership. One, I always say, leadership is for service, first and foremost. That is the number one confession in our nation. They believe leadership is to come and oppress people. Leadership is to go into office and fill your pockets and your belly. Leadership is to go and steal money in Nigeria. Leadership is to go into office and they sit down, have the same sort of people that will begin to scheme and plan how to siphon money from the treasury of the nation. That is the mandate. That is the mindset of the Nigerian leaders that we have. They don't understand that leadership is for service. I remember when I came into the political train and they were interviewing me all over the place and they said, but you don't have experience. I laughed. I said, who has experience? Those ones that are looting money? I said, if it's in a country like the United States or United Kingdom, you will never see anybody hold public office without having to have already served the community. That is public service. Public service is serving the people. Leadership is serving the people. So I now told them, I said, we really need to redefine what leadership is in this nation. I said, the people you people have been voting to powers, they are not leaders. Even the one that their constituency voted for them to go in to represent them, how many of them have passed a bill to try to sort the issues of their people? How many of them, after they have been sent in there, go back to that same community that sent them to go and ask, so how are you people faring in the area of education, in the area of housing, clean water, food on the table? None. When they get there, do you know what they do? You all know what they do. Don't we all know what they do? It is to go and find, please, where is money in this place that, is a, you know, it's our turn. They will begin to talk to themselves. We don't want such leaders again in Nigeria. Leadership is first and foremost going to serve the people. So I tell people, I said, I have been serving the people of Nigeria at a lower level for 2 decades, 20 years. It is people like me, anywhere in civilized country, that they will look for position to come and serve. Because leadership in Nigeria has been turned upside down. So leadership, first and foremost, is about service. Those are the sort of leaders we need. Because election is at the corner. So that when we want to start voting, we won't vote with sentiments. Hello? We won't vote that it is my church member. You see, when it comes to governance, we have to separate it from emotion. And God separates that. When it comes to nations, God does not marry it with church affairs. Though the principles of the church will be used to establish the righteousness of a nation. But God looks for somebody that has the heart to sincerely serve the people righteously. Hello? Did I make any point? God will look for somebody that has the right to righteously serve everybody, whether Muslim, Christian, pagan, because it's a nation. And it's a nation of diverse people. So even if God is going to choose a Christian leader, if he sees that your heart is just about your people, Christianity, he won't use you. Hello? If he sees that the heart of that Muslim person is the one that will show his love to every category of human beings, he would rather pick that person. When it comes to nations, that's why I tell people, I always tell them that God separates the affairs of nation in relationship to church doctrines. People confuse that. They want to use church doctrines to affect national issues. You can't do that. If you look at the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, all the national leaders that are Christians that God used, he always makes sure he marries them with unbelievers. In fact, I used to wonder about that. First and foremost, Moses, that was covenanted to be a deliverer of Israel, he made sure that his mentor was a Eden priest, a Midian priest, not a household of believer, and that he made sure that he married a wife that was not even a part of the household of Israel. Are you listening to me? Then look at Joseph, the prime minister of Egypt. The same thing. He made sure that he married the wife of an Egyptian priest, Babalawo, what you would call Babalawo. Because, you see, God is trying to send a message here that leadership is marrying the unbelievers. It involves everybody. If I am sending you as a leader from my household, don't be selfish to say, I'm a Christian, no? So it is Christians alone I will deal with. Then you don't have the heart of the Father. Because God the Father is about humanity. Hello? God the Father is about humanity. God the Son is about the church, who will eventually come and take over the nations. So you have to have an understanding of those dimensions. Everybody that he has used in that level of taking over the affairs of a nation, he marries them to be joined with the unbelieving part of the nation. So when God sends you as a leader, he's sending you to serve all category of people. So what he wants you to reflect as a believer when you go out there as a leader is to show them the sort of love that usually you will not find out there. In righteousness. You are supposed to show righteousness at every level to every person so that they will begin to ask, this person is different. What is it about you? So that will open a door for you to be able to talk about your God. Am I making sense to you all? Then leadership It's by the people. It's the people that will make a choice. So anytime we're crying in Nigeria, bad leader, it is the leader that you chose. Did anybody choose it for you? Leadership is by the people. Like I tell people in this season we are in right now, what will happen in 2019 will be determined by us. If we still want to go with the same people that are putting us in bondage, looting us, making us suffer what we are suffering right now, it is the choice that we have made. It is the choice that we have made. And the funny thing about Nigerians is that they don't question the sort of people that come into governance. They go with sentiments. They move with what everybody's moving with. Okay, it's Atiku. Everybody's moving with Atiku. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Everybody, Atiku, Atiku, Atiku. What is Atiku's? And I'm not saying Atiku, I'm just using him as an example. What is Atiku's antecedents? Was he among the people that brought us this far? Was he in the category? Some people say, you know, don't leave the two major parties. They are big. They have structures. They have this. They have that. I've stepped down, so don't think I'm saying this now because I want you to vote for me. I'm telling you about the reality of the choices of leaders, the qualities to look out for in leaders. So I keep saying, okay, they have structures. They have big parties. They have the money. All the structure they've had for, how many years are we in Nigeria now? 50? How many? All the structures the two major parties have had, what has it done for us? Hello? What have the leaders of those two structures done for us? How have they brought us this far? Are we evaluating where we are from the two major mega parties? These are the questions we should ask. Leadership is by the people. So we are the ones that will determine the sort of people that will rule us and how this. And I always say something. Because you are going to use the vote to choose a leader. Leadership by the people. And let me tell you, who you choose determines everything about your life. Your vote is your life. Literally. When Nigerians begin to see it like that, they will be careful about the sort of leader they actually want. Your vote is your life because who you choose determines if you will have 24 hours electricity. Who you choose determines the cost of fuel. Who you choose determines if our economy will grow or will collapse. Who you choose determines if your business will survive in the next 4 to 8 years of that person's tenure. Who you choose determines if your parents will be able to continue to pay your school fees. Who you choose will determine if you'll be able to have 3 square meals on your table. Who you choose will determine health care for you and your family. Who you choose will determine the security you have as a people. When we begin to look at this that way, you will not move with emotions. You will not move with the flow of the people. You yourself will individually investigate and not anybody let anybody talk you. That's your vote. You will hold it and say, this is my life. I have the power. You are well able to choose a better person more than what we already have. That is the power we have to choose our leader. Leadership is for the people. So think about it very well. Leadership is by the people. Then number 3 is leadership is for the people. When you go in there, any leader we are looking for, we must look for a leader that we already know the antecedent of this person is for the people. I remember when I began to assemble my team concerning us getting ready to run for this race, one or two of the people didn't really understand my personality or the sort of people I am. And that is because of what they have been seeing about leadership. Immediately they wanted to turn it into a class thing. I laughed. If we go out, And Mama can't go there. Mama can't talk to these people and say, will you people stop that nonsense? You see? You see, you people don't even understand leadership and why you have even come for us to work together. The people you are telling me not to work, to talk to, are they not the ones I want to go and talk to that I want to come and serve? They will turn it into a class thing. That is why most of the leaders that go in there, they don't know the truth about what is happening to the ordinary man. It is what the people that surrounds them tell them. So they live in a different world. They don't know if you are experiencing NEPA failure. That is why they will be telling you when they make press conference that everything is going well, that the economy has increased, it has improved, that everything is just fine. Because everybody they have surrounded themselves with have been lying to them. So first and foremost, when you are dealing with a leader or you want to choose a leader, even for your organization, leadership is at every level, I hope you know, from the church to your business and to everything. You must look for somebody that is people-oriented. Hello? You must be able to watch out and ask questions and look for evidence, antecedents of this person, that this person can relate to different categories of people at every level. You know? And by the time, but thank God my team, 80% of them really understood me, and the ones that did not quickly caught on. Hello? So leadership is for the people. Then, leadership must be sacrificial. Leadership must be sacrificial. Why do you want to have leaders that are telling you to sacrifice? Let us reduce the money of fuel when they are not even increasing what you have to have as a nation. Even to pay 30,000 minimum wage, they are still fighting about it now. Meanwhile, if you look at, read their own salary benefits and what they are looting, they are not ready to sacrifice. So before you choose a leader at any level, you must watch out for that person's life. Is this sort of leader ready to sacrifice? Will this leader put our interest at heart? Will this leader put a lot of things? God will help us in this nation. There are a whole lot of things, a lot of stuff happening out there. You will see our, what they call it now? Is it the budgets? Our nation's budgets and everything. And when you begin to read the budgets and what is due to everybody, you will see that something like the president's air per year is being cut for, is it 1 billion? One ridiculous amount like that. And they are asking you people to sacrifice. You are the ones that should sacrifice, so they are not willing to sacrifice. So we should look out for sacrificial leaders. And you see, oftentimes, I have a problem with church folks. We lecture about this thing so much, but when it is time to make the right choices, we'll go with what everybody else is saying and not allow the Holy Spirit to lead us to make the right choices for what will affect our lives for the next 4 to 8 years. That is very, very crucial. That is very, very crucial. And one of the major problems that Nigeria has, and I'm still having my conversation with the Lord is a continuous one in this area, because I kept asking the Lord why he permitted me to step in and step out. And as an apostle, I have noticed to some extent what he wanted to achieve for now, but I'm not still fully satisfied. It's still a continuous conversation. So maybe in the next 4 years, I will have a full understanding of what he's trying to say. So, like I said, the problems that we have concerning Nigeria is poverty. When I began to notice the level of squalor that we were living in as a nation, it became a big burden. And when I decided to run for election, the Lord told me, he said, when you go into that terrain, talk nothing. Only talk about what I've taught you, what you noticed, what you found out. Talk only about poverty, because everything I've taught you to do, everything I've taught you to know, everything that you have discovered out there is the level of poverty that Nigeria is in. And I got my team and we did our manifesto around on how to solve, you know, poverty. So if you ask me about what sort of vision, you know, must we have for Nigeria, first and foremost, what we need for Nigeria is basic amenities to walk. Just basic amenities. If over 70% of a nation, how many are we in Nigeria that over 70% of a whole nation, we are not the poverty capital of the world. I hope everybody knows that. Poverty capital. Nigeria is now the poverty capital of the world. And I realized when I first came out and I began to talk on TV, and every time they asked me a question, all I was hammering on was what the Holy Spirit told me. Poverty. Nigeria is in poverty. Even before we started doing research, I didn't even know Nigeria was in over 70% poverty, suffering that to that level. But I was just running with what the Spirit of God told me. And I kept saying, we need to eradicate poverty. And we put some points in place on how that could be achieved. And I didn't know a lot of embassies across the nation, they were watching. And they began to invite me. The ambassadors began to invite me for meetings in the different embassy. The first one that called me was British embassy, and they wanted me to meet with their deputy ambassador. And they were like, what got them interested in me was they are interested, all these people, all these international communities, once you say you want to run for the office, they are all looking, they are watching, and they invite anyone that they think makes sense. So they invited me, and they told me that what got them when they were interviewing me with that was the only person in the terrain that was talking about the issue of community service and poverty. And they said everything that I said was just on point. And they did some major interview with me right there in their UK residence office. And a couple of other embassies also invited me. And it was also for the same reason they were inviting me. And UK Parliament, immediately I began to talk about poverty. They now held a meeting and they began to talk about the state of poverty of Nigeria. So, and this got me thinking that maybe as an apostle, God just wanted me to go into that terrain and bring the issue of poverty to a national and international level. You know, God calls us for different reasons. We might not have the full picture, but he will lure us. God to lure people. He lures very well. Because God knows my sort of character. If he had told me, go and start in local government, I would say, please, I am not interested. Hello? Oh, yeah. Go and run for the presidency. Because he knew that the message he wanted me to carry, if I don't go at that level, the sort of people that you want to address that issue might not hear it. Because I've now realized that as soon as he permitted for me to step down, the thing every other aspirant they're not talking out there is about poverty. So ultimately, the issue that God felt should be immediately addressed over the nation, everybody is now carrying that matter. So to me, if that is what I have achieved, to shout that out and for people to pick it up, I believe God is ready to deal with it. Amen. So, if we are talking about, okay, how are you going to, what are your visions? I would say, first and foremost, we need to address the issue of the extreme poverty in the land. Because if 70% of your people are in poverty, almost the whole nation, and if we don't do something about it, what is 17% from 100%, I beg? God forbid bad things. So the few people, all this wealth that we are seeing, a lot of people are forming, you know. People are just forming. It is this cloth that is covering people's secrets. It's few people that have this wealth in Nigeria. Every other person is suffering and smiling. Every other person is what? First and foremost, we must begin to put policies in place that we first alleviate the issue of poverty. And if you ask me, like I was telling them out there, I said, everybody coming in the terrain to give grand promises. I want to do something big. They are lying. If you have not achieved little things, how can you achieve big things? You've not been able to make your light because the light powers the economic sector of a society. And I tell people, I said, it is in God's wisdom before he created anything on earth. What did he first create? He said, let there be light. Because he knows there cannot be productivity without light. There cannot be vision without light. Can you see without light? There cannot be direction. Can you know where you are going if everywhere is dark? You'll just be knocking your head over, which is what we are experiencing in Nigeria. Without light, you will not even be able to have the, you know, comfortable state of mind to sit down and plan. Because if you have to write your vision, you need light. You can't write your vision. Nothing can fall in place. So the first thing, until we address this issue of light, God forbid it, Nigeria will just be going in darkness like this. That is the truth, because Almighty God, before he decided to put anything on this earth, the Bible says he did what? He created light. That is why when there's no light, there's a mood that comes over you. There's a mood that comes over an environment. There's a mood that comes over the nation. And it is what you see that is prevalent over a nation or an environment that will manifest over it. When you have a nation that's always in total darkness, what does darkness represent? Can you just give me like 3 points what darkness represents? Evil. Ignorance. Dullness. Witchcraft. Think of every negative thing. And that is why the country keeps going down. Because in 24 hours of the day, what comes over the nation, 80% of it is what? So how can we have a nation with a vision? How can we plan? How can we write down a vision? How can we run with it? So the first thing to take care of, if God will help us, and we pray, he helps us. If he will help us crack this thing called light, that is the first thing to sort out. Then, when God did that, what was the next thing? In fact, you know, the vision of how to create a nation is very simple, though. Everything is in the scripture. If you read the book of Genesis, step by step, how God created it. He started tilling the ground. He started planting. Food. He started planting. He created a conducive environment before he brought the people in. Because he knew that the people he was going to bring in cannot be productive if the environment is not conducive. We do not have a conducive environment. We do not have the right structures in place. First and foremost, you don't have lights, and you have not given your people a conducive environment to be productive. It was after he created the productive environment, the comfortable environment, he now brought man in. And that's why one president will be saying our youth are lazy. How can our youth be lazy even in this unconducive environment? They still strive so hard to survive. Have you seen our youths inside go slow? Trying to survive. You know, sometimes, even if I don't want something, if I see the one that pursues me too long, I will just buy the thing. Because it'll be, and I'll be asking myself, how much is this thing that this person wants to sell? And you see them running in between the cars, and that car can hit them, and they'll be running. We are not lazy people. We are very resilient people. We are people that are ready to walk. Nigerians have vision, but they don't have a conducive environment. So we need leaders that in the little things they've done, maybe about their organization or their personal life, and if such leaders show up and say, give me a chance to give you the bigger picture, those are the sort of leaders we need. Hello. Thank you, woman of God. We don't need a leader, and I'm sorry, and I'll keep hammering on it because we don't like the truth. A leader that has only been tending 150 cows for how many years before he started asking? For 30 years. And Nigerians are still fighting for that leader to come out. And some Christians can even kill you if you talk anything wrong. What do we really want? It's what we want that God will give to us. It's what we want that God will give to us. Ah, it's after three. Okay. So I'm sorry. I need to round up. So I really want to take some questions. So let me just recap quickly so that I can quickly, or you can expand me by asking me questions. So leadership is about, what did I say? Can somebody say it out quickly? Mm-hmm. Okay, I have a lot of things that I put down here, but time will not permit me. A leader must have vision. I've said that, but without light, can you see to even have vision? A leader must have passion. You know, you must look for somebody when you have watched their lifestyles. You want them to be leaders over you, even for a church. Even for your little business, create a situation where you can see their passion. You cannot be good in anything you are offering the people if you don't have passion for it. In fact, the sort of passion I used to enter the political terrain, before God could bring me down, he had to send angels. My people know. I went with this passion that under how many months we took the whole 36 states, only two states left, Abby. Almost 36, 32, or 34, sorry. We took the 34 states, and we're going to unfold all of that. Immediately, they announced that we can officially start really the proper campaign. We were ready. That was the sort of passion. I came in with that passion that, look, enough. If these people can't do it, we can do it now. We have capacity. We are able. Listen to me. That is who we are. Jesus Christ said, occupy till I come. You should not be afraid to dominate your environment. You should not be afraid to dominate your locality. Anything you have your passion for, believe you can take it. Because you have dominion authority. You have the dominion power. As I'm here, I don't believe anything is impossible for me. There's no impossibility in my agenda. In fact, when I move sometimes, the people around me are always afraid. And when I move, it's only God that can stop me, I'm telling you, and his word. Like I tell people, I say it's not because I'm too good that I step down. It was the word that I gave. And the word is God. Because I went into a consensus agreement. As if I had known, they would use that consensus to stop me. And that was the newcomer in me that agreed to that. Next time, they won't catch me with that one until the last stage. God also permitted it. I gave my word, and I had to step down. I was ready. I was ready. My heart was ready. My spirit was ready. I'm like, what is it now? We have the capacity. We have it. And when we put our mind, when we engage it with the mind of God, the Holy Ghost moves with us. He can make anything happen. Anything can happen. And if we don't engage our mind like that, Nigeria will not change you. If we keep looking at, there's no way a newcomer will take over. There's no way. Let us continue to manage. Let me tell you, there's a prediction. And I pray, because the righteous are praying, that it will not happen upon Nigeria. But you know God, what? God is not sentimental. He will give you choices. And it is the choices you make that will happen for you. There's a prediction that latest, in the next 5 years, Nigeria might be extinct. Do you know, in our research, when we started doing our political move, we found out that a lot of nations that went into refugee, that their nations collapsed. 80% of the people that were refugees were the richest people in their country because they felt too comfortable in their space. And when things were going bad, they refused to believe it. They thought it is the poor people it will happen to. Until the whole nation finally collapsed on their head. And people that had industry, nations that were, people that were making things happen in their nations, they ended up being refugees. That will not happen for us and to us in Jesus' name. But another warning, don't say because you are in the church, you know. Mordecai told Esther something. He said, don't say because you are in the palace and you are calling God or you are enjoying. Because sometimes Christians are so naive. Very naive people. They say, I'm praying and we are praying. We are in the church. Whoa. God is not sentimental. He will give you choices and he will speak to you. He does. If bomb will land, it will not land on us in Jesus' name. But if it has been mandated to land upon the whole Nigeria, he will not separate all church. Say, okay, because my church is, they are my church. He's a liar. You know the funny thing? Before it lands outside, it will land in the church. Because he said, judgment starts in my house. You know, at the time when they were bombing churches and everything, because my own, I look deeper into the scriptures and I see things differently. When people, it's only churches. I say, it's only, they will start with churches. Where else will they start? It's in the scriptures. They won't start with outsiders. It's in the church. Because we have the capacity to do more. And if we are not doing it, judgment will start with us first. Because we are well able. We have been equipped to make the right choices, push out the right people, do the right things. Because if you are a church, you want righteous leader, and in your little corner, in your church, you are not being righteous in the assignment you have been given. So, what are you? If you, as a member of this church, you are still giving bribe. So, what are you? What are you? What are you spilling into the nation? If you, as a member of this church, you are in an organization and you are still messing up documents and doing things illegally, what are you? The people in governance, are they ghosts? They are members of churches and mosques. They hear preachings and teachings. But they contribute to the decay of the society. And you say judgment will not start in the house of God. So if we are demanding righteousness from leaders, we ourselves must be found to be righteous. It's the seed we sow, that is what we will receive. And I'm always saying something when I minister to leaders, and we are talking about leadership, especially leadership forum. I say this all the time, that what Nigeria is not suffering from good leaders from the church. We have the greatest teachers in Nigeria. We have the biggest church. We are well able. We have even just built one of the biggest churches on the face of the earth in Nigeria. And the pastor is my friend, and I love him. That's not my issue. My issue is, if we are talking about this righteousness that we as a church, we are supposed to represent, why is it not spilling into our nation? Because the spiritual controls the physical. So something is definitely wrong. We are not bringing out the right fruit from the church. And not that our leaders are not trying. They are doing their best. But why are you all not receiving the education? Why are we not putting it to use? Because when we are putting it to use, we are light of the world. It will illuminate our world. Something is wrong, people. So we all these things to change Nigeria is about us. It is we. We have to make the decision of what we want from our nation. A leader must have passion. A leader must learn to be a good decision maker. I won't break it down. There's no time. A leader must be a team builder. A leader must have character. And we have to look at all of these things. And I'll close my talking on this note so that we can ask questions. I have a whole lot more, but I know that God will give me chance and time again very soon. God bless this house. Thank you.
You can do better than that. Keep clapping. That's awesome. Keep clapping unto the Lord. You can do better than that. Amen. Let's sit down. Thank you, ma. That's awesome. I think from my perspective, the charge from Reverend Ideh this afternoon is not only to the leaders, but also to us, the led. Because oftentimes in our discussions about leadership as Nigerians, we always put it at the doorstep of the leaders. At least if she did not say something indicting us, she said that we are responsible for the leadership that we have. And she also told us that sometimes, of course, God at a point called Nebuchadnezzar, my servant. I read it from my Bible. It's in your Bible. So for all that Nebuchadnezzar did to the people of God, God allowed it. If we are crying and we are shouting today, God also allowed it. Because if, for instance, seated right here, a census of those who have their PVCs or TVCs is done, I'm sure at that level we already missed it. Hello? At that level, we already missed it. At that level, we are saying that anything can be there. Anybody can be there. And if anybody can be there, why should we complain? Put your hands together for the woman of God once more. The role of leadership, governance, and the vision for Nigeria. Praise the Lord. Okay, like we did in the morning session, it's time for questions and comments and contributions. We have only 20 minutes to do this. I think the best way to do it, let somebody, go into the congregation with a microphone. I will take the first three. Okay, I have seen the first hand, so that not this time. I have seen the second hand, and I have seen a third hand. Praise God. So let's start from this point. Where is the microphone? Any other microphone? If there's none, you take this. We want to take your questions and your contributions. The woman of God and our Father in the Lord, I think together we take these questions. So I will take the first three, ma, after which we take the others, so as to manage our time well. So the microphone goes here first. Just take my direction. Then after, it goes that way here. Okay, thank you.
Praise God. I want to thank you, ma, for that wonderful teaching. For me, there's this question that's always troubling my mind. Because from experience, we've seen Christians that actually went into, power. They were burning for the Lord. But along the line, they fell out. Why? Because of the environment they found themselves. So they didn't see the same kind of people that had the same passion with them. So they were surrounded with, people that don't have the same passion that they have. So along the line, they had no choice than to join them. Now today, that is still the same problem. No conducive environment. Yes, you said you had passion. You had a great passion for this country. But the environment is not there. How could you have been able to create an enabling environment for yourself? How could you have been able to surround yourself with the kind of people that have the same passion that you have, that will enable you to succeed? Praise the Lord.
Okay, thank you. She wanted to know how she was able to, put up a team of good people that will work with her. Okay. Yeah, please, the next person there, please make your questions, No, that's not where you're supposed to go, no? I took my three people first. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. And thank you, ma, for a very enlightening talk. There is something we call political entrepreneurship. And you've entered the political space. If you step out now, it's like starting a business and not following up. I don't know before now how far you've been doing the work, but I think if you were to stay in politics, not necessarily competing, but in line with other work you are doing in communities, creating political awareness among the people you are engaged with, over time, they will imbibe your passion. Over time, they will imbibe your values. Over time, they will come to know the God you know. And you will now have a set of foot soldiers to work with. The level you started was very beautiful. And if you had access to students, focus on them a little bit, the youth that have been described as lazy by Nigerian leaders, I think you could have a lot of enduring effect. Because we lack political entrepreneurs. People enter politics today and they want to reap today. Nobody wants to invest over a long period of time. So I'd like to suggest that you consider political entrepreneurship.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that's a comment. Just be watching me this way. You can see me. Just watch me. Yes. I know I'm short, but at least. Praise the Lord. Don't mind me. Yeah, that's in there.
Thank you very much, Ma. That was quite transformational. And my question goes thus. You talked about leadership being unable to identify with the problems of the people. And this is my question. See, I try to reconcile the Nigerian, case with that of the American, because what we actually do here is federalism. And then we try to copy the Americans. So, but the Americans don't do it exactly the way we do it. So, you talked about our leaders not being able to know the core problems of the people because of the people that they surround themselves with. So, my question is, in Nigeria now, just like you have said, who do we blame? Now we have SCs to SCs. We have PAs to PAs. And these leaders know these things. What are they trying to do? Thank you.
Great questions. Great questions. In fact, let me quickly comment on the very first question about, you know, people going into the political space and the environment is not conducive and they get consumed by the environment, and before you know it, they are part of the system and they are doing what every other person is doing. And I think I addressed that on the pulpit, because if you are well grounded in what you have been taught in your church, if you take in what they have been teaching you to stand on a righteous ground, darkness does not comprehend light. That's what the scripture says. Darkness can never comprehend light. If you are true light and you have taken into your spirit the totality of the presence of God, Jesus, who is light, you are the one that will go and transform that environment. For that environment to have transformed you, you did not learn anything and you did not take anything in from what you were being taught in church. And that is just the truth, whether we want to believe it or not. People can't corrupt you if you carry the light of Christ. In fact, they will be doing it around every other person, they will not be able to do it to you. In fact, they will tell everybody, don't go to Elishama. If you go to her, you know she won't agree. But if you say we should bring her in, then we must agree to our terms. You'll find out that that's what they will begin to talk about you. So if everybody has to feel that the place is like this, the environment, nowhere is conducive. Even the church can corrupt you. I know a lot of people that have been corrupted in church more than they were in the world. Everything is about you, not that environment. You have to make up your mind that I want to be different in every sphere. It is about you, not about that environment. And once you can stand on who you have been called to be in God, the environment cannot consume you. You'll be the one to consume the environment. And I need to understand, the other question was that, okay, that I should start building food soldiers. And in my community project that I've been doing, yes, I've built food soldiers for 20 years. I felt I had to take it to the next level. There was another question people were asking me. They were like, oh, yes, why don't you start either as a senator or at all those levels? And I told them, I said, my strength is not in making laws. My strength is in executing. I have executed taking care of the lowly. I go to an environment, I see the situation of people, I have to make quick, decisive decision about them. Take them out of there. Relocate them. Rehabilitate them. Do something to change their status quo immediately. So going into all of those areas will not allow me the capacity to transform the nation the way I would have wanted to. I wanted to go in as a transformational leader so that I can be backed with the power of the constituency that will give me the authority to be able to transform the nation with the vision that I have. But I felt if I started at those levels, the powers at that levels will limit me. I needed the executive power of the presidency backed by the constitution. So that was why I had to start at that level. And you see, like I said, as a believer, never be afraid of any level. We are the people that spring with heights. We don't spring from the low. We see problems and we climb that problem and we shoot up. That is who we are as eagles. And you see, whatever capacity the Spirit of God is inspiring you to start. You might want to achieve something even by you saying, I'm going in there. You understand what I'm saying? Just like I explained that I've seen something in the atmosphere that has even been achieved by me even saying that. Because if I've taken any other capacity, my voice would not have been heard. What I wanted the nation to be addressed would not have been heard. But by saying presidency, everybody wanted to listen to me. And the issue of poverty was brought into national prominence. And that is the capacity of an apostle. You make noise for people to face a particular direction so that they can start addressing it. And I was able to achieve that. And I think I deserve an accolade.
Put your hands together for the Lord. Put your hands together for her.
I know she doesn't have enough time to take some more. The question of the gentleman, you want to answer? Question. The question, can you just summarize it again.
Yeah, his question was to the effect that in these days of political dispensation, where we have SAs to SAs to SAs, political assistant to the assistant to the driver of the president.
Yes.
who is to blame? That's your question, sir.
No, it was okay. More than that.
Okay.
Yeah, it was okay, the essence.
You talked about the leader not being able to identify the problems of the people in the course of a message.
Yes.
So I'm asking this question. I said, because you know you have a lot of people shredded around the leader. Okay. So, and as a result of this, she said the leader will not be able to identify the problems of the people. So I said, who are we going to blame when the leader now has so many people around him, you know, like avoiding the people from reaching.
I think it's clear. Thank you so much. Let's celebrate him. I think our speaker did touch on that when she had to, beyond what the people reported or wanted her to do, insist on what should be the case. And I think the truth of the matter is that even though our Nigerian leaders are being shielded, I still recollect when the bomb blast happened under Obasanjo at Maryland. How many of you remember that killed how many people? Hundreds of people. I will never forget when Obasanjo came in there to see the scene, and because of the annoyance of the people, they were booing and, you know, just making fun and expressing their displeasure and anger at him. And in his normal manner, he retorted angrily and said something, not the exact word, but something like, well, am I even supposed to be here at all? I can't forget. I can't. And the people reacted more violently, and he left. Later, he now tried to apologize. But then it was too, as far as I'm concerned, it was too late to apologize. It just showed there was a fundamental misunderstanding of who you are as a leader. The people are complaining. They are telling you, they are expressing their displeasure, and the first comment that came out of your mind is, am I supposed to be here? A picture that reveals how much our leaders are insulated from the reality on ground. The person to be blamed, if you ask me, is the leader. There's no way a leader, you see, the Bible says the reason every priest that will minister in the things of God to people is taken from the people is because he himself must suffer, experience the same thing before he can qualify to minister to people. They cannot, with all sincerity, claim they have no idea of what is happening, because they do know. Obasanjo came from prison to become president, from chicken farmer to becoming an international statesman all again suddenly. He can't claim that he didn't know what is happening. But like I said, he did try to apologize for me. The damage was already done. So there are things leaders can do. I don't think, unless one has come to a point where your mind is all twisted, something is wrong with you. When sycophants surround you that you don't know. Yeah, every leader, you should be able to tell that this one is a sycophant. This one is a bootlicker. This one is just overpraising you. This one is realistic. We should know that. I think the point now becomes their personality. Some people can't stand those who look up to them and tell them the truth the way it ought to be. So because of that personality of not being able to accommodate the truth, no matter how bitter it may be, then they rather do away with such people. And sycophants are very good at noticing what you like. And the moment they notice you have a tendency to pander towards such people, then they increase their capacity for sycophancy, and you keep enjoying. So it now looks like they don't know. They truly know. They are the one that allow themselves. That is why, finally, God has never absolved a leader of the blame of responsibility. God doesn't. He doesn't, because for you to even come there in the first place, it is that assumption that you know that brought you there, or the reality that you know. And when you get in there, you have all the ability to be able to know more than other people know. All right, maybe, can you take a few more questions? Man? You're done, okay. Yes, one more. Can I do that? There was that hand I saw. Okay, Pastor, it was Pastor, okay. By virtue of this white beard, let's allow him to be the one giving the question.
Thank you so much, woman of God. I really salute your courage, your passion, and your zeal for a new Nigeria. This is, permit me to go a little bit specific.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people are disgusted with this present government. And looking at the structure politically, it is like we have somebody who can contend with the present government in the person of Atiku. Now, a lot of people have listened to Moalo, listened to Feladurotoye, listened to Showore, and people are beginning to feel that these people have something to offer.
Yeah.
And there was an initial move, you know, for them to consolidate their effort so that they can present a united interest.
Yeah.
That has been split right now. And so people are looking at it that in the present status quo, there is a possibility that as many people cast their votes to Moalo, to Showore, to Fela, that's going to split the vote that would have been gotten if they were a concerted effort, giving an opportunity for the present evil to continue to perpetuate itself. How can we come out of this situation? Thank you.
In fact, that's it. That's a situation I'm presently dealing with all the presidential aspirants, because we are all colleagues now, and we are all on the same platform. I'm still with them. We talk every day on that platform, and I'm actually begging them. In fact, I had to give the first example by stepping down. That was why I actually stepped down. I'm like, I have passion, and you all know it. So let's come into a consensus agreement. Let us amongst ourselves vote for somebody. One amongst us. Then we all use our collective strength with our different spheres of influence to push that one person so that we can ultimately achieve the end result of pushing out the opposition. Because the end result is that we want to push out the opposition so that we, the new generation, can actually have the opportunity to present, you know, the activation of bringing back, giving back to a new Nigeria. And few of us agreed. First and foremost, we started off with 18 people. You know, we agreed, and we went into a closed door meeting, and we put in the criteria that we're going to use to vote for ourselves. When it wanted to start, before we knew it, a couple of them dropped off. It was remaining 11. From 11 that stayed true, before the final result was read, they dropped off. It was remaining only 6 of us. So I find that hard for the new generation that are saying they want to come and effect a change. If you want to come and effect a change and you don't first submit your ambition, then you will not submit your power when you get there. When you are required to submit that power for the collective interest of the people, you will not. Which was what I was trying to tell them. And I demonstrated that there. I said, in as much as I have passion for this, I am willing, and I will go along with the consensus agreement. They were all shocked. In fact, in our meeting, they always called me the terrorist, because I was always terrorizing the men, truly. And I had to make them know that don't treat me like this because I'm a woman. I won't agree because I'm a woman, you know? So when I'm coming, all of them sit up. They were like, have you shown Elishama? Has she agreed? So they were shocked that I agreed, because Nigeria interest should be above our ambition. It's about nation, the collective interest of the people. And if we cannot come to that agreement that we are ready to drop our ambition just for Nigeria to survive, then you are not ready for service. And till yesterday, I was still telling them on that platform, I beg them every day, you people are going to make it easy to hand over this thing to these people. And all of them are still running. They are not answering. So I'm praying that maybe before the end of this month, everybody could come to their senses and we'll all come together. Because we are splitting our votes. Because people will say, should I go with Showore? Should I go with Mongal? Should I go? So these votes will be scattered at the end of the day. But we are still talking to each other. We are still talking to each other. And I'm believing God that they will all see reason at the end of the day. Because as of the time I drop off, everybody on the consensus table they backed out. If they don't see reason, we've lost 2019. Instead of losing 2019, A lot of people have been saying, okay, it's I. So they are looking at, okay, that's why a lot of people are not looking at Atiku. That, okay, Atiku has the capacity, the money, the structure. Okay, maybe they should use Atiku to push out the opposition. But this is my thinking. This is my thinking. We were in the same situation just 4 years ago. Everybody just, at any cost, wanted Jonathan out without looking at all the issues. What I am praying for, and this is what I am daring God, because the Bible says, if I see one righteous, I've told God, I said, my seed has gone into that terrain, which I believe as an apostle, maybe that was one of the things he sent me to go and do. I said, my seed has gone down there. For the sake of the elect and the people that are praying, and my seed that has gone in there, you will step in somehow. Because I still don't believe any of these people can bring us a new Nigeria. I have to be sincere about that. No matter how it looks like, I am praying that God will supernaturally step in by touching the hearts of the new. Or do something. Just raise a Rollins to come on.
Let's celebrate God's servant. She has to be. Put your hands together. Give her an applause. Thank you so much. We'll allow you to take your exit. And okay, that's right. So please, thank you. Celebrate her. All right. You can please take your seat. We have a little more time, and I think we should keep the discourse on a little bit so that we can address this. Let me comment on that last question, and I give it to you to ask more questions, and we can answer. Are we still together? Please listen. All right. Okay. We'll take more questions. Now, the reason why I prodded Reverend Ideh to please speak about what happens if they don't agree is because if we are not pragmatic, we are not practical, we will keep having this problem. God forbid, and I say it with my mouth wide open, and anybody that wants to tweet it can tweet it and put it on social media if you like. God forbid that Nigeria has another 4 years of this locust called Buhari administration. God forbid. God forbid. But guess what? As much as God forbid and we forbid, that is how we will allow this madness to continue. The argument that we have a Christian vice president is neither here nor there. Doesn't make sense. Now, if you don't understand what is at stake and you lack capacity to intellectually analyze the whole details, number one, please listen to me, because I'm making a very strong statement here. If you lack the intellectual capacity to analyze what is at stake and look at it from a historical perspective and know what is before us in the near future, please don't talk on the basis of emotion. What is at stake is deep. I've been privileged by virtue of one or two involvements here and there to know a couple of things that you will never find in the public space. And I am telling you, I'm not a politician. I'm to the extent that I'm interested in the well-being of Nigeria, I am a politician. I mean, that's what politics is all about. But I'm not involved in partisan politics. There's a difference. We are all politicians, just as some are partisans, some are not. I'm not a card-carrying member of any of the party, not because you can't be, but because I am not. I'm very interested. I voted in the last election. This election, I'm going to vote. I have my PVC. So I'm very active. I'm engaged. I'm involved. My challenge is the fact that if we split, Mogalu is excellent. Showori, here and there, saying some radical things, you know, and all of them. I feel his mouth is too loud. He's talking too much, insulting people. Before you get into power, that's inexperienced, that's childish, that's immature. I know young people like him because he's saying some things they lack, because he can be, and all of those stuff, you know. What's his name? Fela Duro Toye, thumbs up. Mogalu, thumbs up. Obi Ezekwesili, thumbs up. Those three are my preferred personal candidates. I know you have yours, okay? I'm not saying go for mine. Those are my preferred personal candidates because they have the integrity, they have the intelligence, they have the capacity to deliver on a new Nigeria. Fela Duro Toye, Kingsley Mogale, and Obi Ezekwesili. But here is the problem. The problem is if they don't agree, it's an indirect way of submitting to the same regime. If they don't agree. In fact, there's already a theory, which I hope is not true, that the parties in power and some leading opposition are part sponsoring these people and insisting they remain as a way of dividing the other votes. And knowing politicians, you can't deny anything for them. Did you hear the statement Reverend Ideh said? If you cannot submit your ambition, is it when you have power that you cannot submit to the people? You can't argue with reason. You can't argue with that. So my point is, let's keep praying. Nobody has it all. Nobody know it all. But let's keep praying. And here's for me, Lord, whatever you would do in order to give us a better nation, go ahead and what? And do it. But please, as far as I'm concerned, it is very clear to my mind that if the opposition does not come together, the young people come together to agree, we can as well put all of them one side. Because the only thing they will do is divide all the important votes and give the current regime another 4 years. Why am I against the current regime? You don't have to go too far. This man does not have the capacity to produce Nigeria that is better. It's not possible. If you don't have it, you don't have it. He doesn't have the education. He doesn't have the experience. There is nothing on ground. Not one thing on ground that anybody can point to as a reason for him. The integrity that has been spoken about, all his compromise in the area of only promoting his people had made rubbish of the integrity. There is nothing that they complain about in PDP that is not happening in APC. So nobody should sell anybody on the basis of integrity. That thing is nonsense. 3 years, they have not done anything enough to justify any result. But the only thing we have seen, now I'm a Christian, unapologetically so. I am very clear on the fact that there is no way this government can deny the accusation of Islamic fundamentalism. There is no way anybody can argue that against me. I know so much about what is happening. We know so much about what is happening. On the basis of that, I can't trust him from here till tomorrow. I cannot trust him. The vice president putting somebody to take over as a, what do you call it, a director of state security. Is that not what he did? You know, the moment the man came, it's like saying, what nonsense. And change the man, and not one person is speaking. Not one person is. Is he only from the north? Not just north, radical northern Muslims. That we have people who are qualified to take security apparatus. One redeemed Christian Church of God pastor, because redeemed Christian Church of God is the biggest beneficiary of the vice presidential position, not the body of Christ. In fact, not even the whole redeemed, a small sector of the redeemed Christian Church of God. They are the one benefiting the political offices, the patronage, and all of them. Redeemed. One small sector, not the whole redeemed. So they are the one promoting and using their cronies and acronies and all kinds of people to promote that. Listen to me. From when he came in up till now, there is not, I have not seen anything happening. In fact, there's so much more happening that we can't even talk about publicly. What am I saying? The truth of the matter is that the Buhari administration is one of the worst things that have happened in the 21st century to Nigeria. On every reckoning, on every, I know we have APC and PDP and whatever be your party, but listen to me. On every reckoning, they are not doing well. They're not doing well. So we have no reason to bring them back. But much more is the fact that this is the first administration I am seeing in the history of Nigeria, where you come into office in the first 4 years, where politicians, by virtue of their pretentious nature of things, who want to do everything to pacify, serve as if they are pacifists, they are middle ground, they are not extreme. But this administration from day one went on the extreme. You give them another 4 years, extremity will be at the highest level. I have never seen this current administrator commiserate with people and victims. The moment people are being killed by all these people, all of that, no voice, nothing, no serious concern, and all of that happening, is so difficult to absolve yourself of complicity in such a matter. So men and brethren, let's wake up to the reality. Let's wake up to the reality. The reality of the matter is that the future and the destiny of a number of us are at stake. We must be politically and well incentivized to be able to do the right thing. God bless you. We're going to take a few more questions, and I want as many more people to contribute. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Daddy, sorry. The microphone is in my hand. It is my microphone. Nothing else to add. God bless you. Nothing else to add after all that Daddy have said. Can we pray? Alright, let's pray. If the microphone is in my hand, if it's a mistake, you gave it to me. Let's go and chew on what we have heard. It's settled. Praise God. Father, we thank you for another opportunity. We thank you, Lord. We are here today so that you will bless us, and you have blessed us. We are here today so that you speak to us the way forward, and you have spoken to us. We are here today through the mouth of the servants of God. You have given us direction, even as we approach 2019. We are here today because we cannot continue to complain when we are indolent by the side. We are here today to know that it's time to go out, even if it is working for our personal lives, to ensure that Christians, to ensure that the general masses in Nigeria do not continue to suffer. We cannot just come and pray alone. We must step out and act. Father, let all that we have heard since morning be incubated in our hearts. Through it all, may we come out at the end of this election season thanking you for all you have used us to do. Thank you, Abba Father. Let your name be glorified. As we prepare for the evening session, take control and let your name be honored all through this program. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Okay. Praise the Lord. Now, before you step out, let's not use all the political grammar to forget that it's our daddy's birthday today and we are celebrating. Put your hands together. Just clap, clap. Let's not, you know, lose sight of that. And the main celebration is this evening, 5 p.m. Praise God. 5 p.m. That's the main celebration. Please don't go far. I beg of you. Let no Lagos traffic catch you. Remain around. God bless you.
Assembly, raising leaders.